6 months after birth, the breastfeeding mother has 100,000 white cells per mil. Now, we're not exactly sure what they're doing there, but they have 100,000 white cells per mil of breast milk. That's 10 times what you would expect to be in your peripheral blood. What about, these are the cells, and I'll let you study these at your leisure, because, who wants to discuss this? Well, but the immune factors in breast milk. When we talk about immune factors in breast milk, we often just talk about antibodies, right? But antibodies in this list of immune factors is only the first two lines under antimicrobial compounds. Look at all the rest of these things. So maybe one day, formula companies will succeed in putting antibodies into formula. But what about that other stuff? This is a whole dynamic, living process that occurs that helps to protect babies against infection. And it's just not so that it's only about antibodies. And these are not, okay, these are not even all the immune factors which are present in breast milk, but absent from formula. So, here's a mother who is breastfeeding. We know she's breastfeeding because she has time to read the newspaper. And let's say that she's been exposed to MRSA. That's the one that everybody talks about all the time, but it's not the only one. So she's exposed. And in her gut, some of these bacteria will interact with this M cell. Now, M cells are different from the usual cells that are present on the epithelial cells of the gut, because the epithelial cells try to reject those bacteria. But the M cells actually absorb the microbe and pass it through a number of white cells until it activates this B cell here. And the B cell then enters into the lymph, and within 24 to 48 hours, that B cell is now a plasma cell producing antibodies against that MRSA to which the mother was just exposed not that long ago. And in the meantime, those other immune factors are helping to protect the baby. Now remember that if the mother has MRSA, an infection with MRSA, she's had it for a while already. It doesn't make any sense to separate the mother and the baby or to not allow breastfeeding when breastfeeding can actually protect the baby. But it happens all the time. These are just better diagrams than the one I recommended. So I'll just show you so you can look at it and see how it works. And this is a secretory. This is an antibody which is SIGA. And people will say to mothers, you can't breastfeed because you have autoimmune hemolytic anemia. And the antibodies that are breaking down your red cells will appear in the milk and cause your baby to have the same problem. Or you have anti-thyroid antibodies and that will cause the baby to become hypothyroid. But this is not true. The usual antibodies that cause these problems are a different type of antibody than IgA. But furthermore, they hardly ever get into the milk. And even if they got into the milk, then the they don't get into the milk because the SIGA has a secretory component on it which allows it to go into the milk. But most antibodies don't have that. And even if they somehow get into the milk, they would be destroyed in the baby's stomach. Why? Because they are antibodies. They are proteins. And what happens to proteins that you swallow? They are digested in the stomach to start with and then in the gut. But there is this J chain on SIGA which protects it from being destroyed by the baby's stomach acid. This is just showing that they're different. I'll skip that. Do maternal antibodies pass on autoimmune disease to the baby? And the answer is no. The predominant immunoglobulin in human milk is secretory IgA, and there's no evidence that secretory IgA is a pathogenic antibody in autoimmune disease. In any case, secretory IgA is not absorbed via the gut, so it doesn't get into the baby's body. And there's no evidence that IgG in human milk is absorbed into the circulation either. And IgM also. Okay, oligosaccharides, what are they? Well, these are sugars, but these are the original prebiotics, and everybody's all hot about giving babies prebiotics. Well, they were always in breast milk. So are probiotics. And this is showing the size of the thymus in babies who are exclusively breastfed, partially breastfed, or formula fed. And as you see, the thymus is much bigger in the baby who is exclusively breastfed. Now, if you ask the neonatologist, the babies who are admitted to the NICU are often under stress, as you can imagine, and their thymus disappears. And that is one of the effects of the stress, of illness, or whatever that baby has. Okay, and that is prostaglandins, which are excreted into the milk, and we think that it has an immune function, also a function in the development of the baby's gut, but it's not in formula. Okay, now, think about this. Formula has about the same amount of protein as breast milk. Oh, really? I don't think that's true. Breast milk contains about, when the baby's 3 months of age, say, 8 to 10 grams per liter of protein. This is somewhat less than most formulas, which contain 12 to 15 grams per liter or more. But up to 60 to 65% of the protein in breast milk is lactoferrin, which is not absorbed from the gut and therefore not available for nutritional purposes. About 6% of the protein is also antibody, which is also not absorbed from the gut and therefore not available for nutritional purposes. So at most, babies are getting 4.5 grams per liter of protein for their nutritional needs. And babies can't grow on this amount. Ask any dietitian, but they do. Formula then contains way too much protein, 3.5 times more protein. And what is that associated with? Increased insulin resistance and later increased risk of diabetes. Well, what about S100B protein? S100B is an acidic calcium-binding protein of the EFN family, characterized by the most common calcium-binding motif of a helix-loop-helix structure. I haven't got the vaguest idea what that means. But apparently it's important for brain function, so I guess I didn't get enough. It's present in much higher concentration in breast milk than in formula, and higher in mature breast milk than in colostrum. There are stem cells in breast milk, we now believe that. And I talked to you first about this one already, so I'm not going to repeat that. All this is very nice, but does it make a difference for the baby? And the answer is, probably very much so. You bet it does. The studies are all there, but so many people prefer not to believe them because, my son was never breastfed, he's got a PhD, yeah. Okay, they prefer not to believe it. As soon as one study comes out doubting the results of many studies, we hear, oh, you see, formula is just as good as breast milk. And studies showing risks of formula are never as well done as studies showing no risk. And people will just never move from this notion that formula is just as good as breast milk. But let me make a suggestion to you. We keep talking about all these improved formulas, right? You don't have to be very old to have seen all sorts of new formulas or new formulations of formulas come onto the market, right? And they are told, and we are told in the advertising, that the formula is so much better than it was. And therefore, it's almost as good as breast milk. Except, remember what they're saying. This formula is so much better than it used to be. Which means that the formula that it used to be was not very good. Right? But, well, your son might have gotten a post-grad if he had been breastfed. Here's just one study. We tend to ignore these studies. This is a study that came in pediatrics, and it's very unusual that such a study would be ignored by the media, but I don't remember seeing anything about this in the media. So this is about SIDS, and the conclusions, breastfeeding is protective against SIDS, and this effect is stronger when breastfeeding is exclusive. The recommendation to breastfeed infants should be included with all with other SIDS risk reduction messages to both reduce the risk of SIDS and promote breastfeeding for its many other infant and maternal health benefits. Didn't see a thing about it. Okay. Many did not believe that long-chain polyunsaturated fatty acids in breast milk could make babies smarter. And maybe they don't. But when the formula companies came out with their new formulas with long-chain polyunsaturated fatty acids, I have heard pediatricians say, that formula is just as good as breast milk, as if this one change, adding long-chain polyunsaturated fatty acids, it just turns everything around in the formulas now like breast milk. Long-chain polyunsaturated fatty acids make babies smarter only when they are in formula? I don't think so. Okay, in fact, there is no evidence that simply adding DHA and ARA to formula give the benefits that they're supposed to. These compounds need to be added in the correct proportions, and they are not absorbed from formula the same way as they're absorbed from breast milk. And so studies do not support any benefit when added to formula. And this is a link to a group called Cornucopia, at Cornucopia, and they are an agricultural oversight group that watches out on American agricultural policy. So they're not, they don't have an axe to grind here. They just want to find out. And basically what they say in this report is that babies are getting sick with these formulas that include long-chain polyunsaturated fatty acids. Now, formula is also a heavy metal cocktail, and it has too much aluminum. Cow's milk has 100 times more aluminum than breast milk. Soy formula, up to 2,000 times more than breast milk. It has too much manganese, too much lead, too much cadmium, too much iron, and aluminum is a real problem. There's this article about aluminum and Alzheimer's disease. This study, not study, this is a newspaper article. It says Canada should limit tap water to aluminum, but they didn't, and it doesn't matter because, you know, politicians say anything they want, anytime they want. But more on aluminum. Okay, this study was published, or this article was published in 2010 in a journal called BMC Pediatrics. And what does this study show? Recent research demonstrating the vulnerability of infants to early exposure to aluminum serves to highlight an urgent need to reduce the aluminum content of infant formulas to as low a level as is practically possible. Now, these people are not crazed breastfeeding radicals, because listen to the first sentence of the second paragraph. Infant formulas are integral to the nutritional requirements of preterm and term infants. So they're not saying, don't ever breastfeed, don't ever formula feed. While it has been known for decades that infant formulas are contaminated with significant amounts of aluminum, there is little evidence that manufacturers consider this to be a health issue. Well, of course, because we don't push them. Aluminum is non-essential and is linked to human disease. There is evidence both immediate and delayed of both immediate and delayed toxicity in infants, and especially preterm infants exposed to aluminum, and it is our contention that there is still too much aluminum in infant formula. And errors, recalls of infant formulas. The first time I ever did this was back in 1998, so I went back 20 years. And I won't go through every detail here, but it just shows how often infant formulas are recalled because they're improperly manufactured. And remember, they are manufactured. Okay, not all of these are North American products, but the vast majority are. So an important message from Nestle Canada. Unfortunately, an incorrect thermocouple was installed in the ceiling area, resulting in an inaccurate temperature reading of the area around the can during the final stages of canning for not these 9-day codes. In other words, your formula is probably contaminated. Alright, and then that formula was contaminated. Three babies died in Israel when they left the vitamin B6 out of the formula. Several others were hospitalized. Another recall from powdered formula and infections that babies developed, including meningitis from that. And for those who are fond of exotic exotic foods, here are a few recalls because of what's been found in infant formula, rat hair, beetle parts and beetle larvae. That's protein, don't worry. Pieces of glass. And melamine. Oh, yes, we forgot already, right? Okay, and I think we have progressed. This is from France, but it's based on a pun, this cartoon. But basically, babies, unscrupulous people were adding lye to milk, to make it, to make more money, and babies died, not surprising. There are risks for the mother. I won't go into a lot of detail, but mothers who do not breastfeed have an increased risk of ovarian cancer, endometrial cancer, and breast cancer, including osteoporosis as well, and iron deficiency. Why do they have an increased risk of iron deficiency? Because they don't get their periods for a much longer period of time, and delayed evolution of the uterus. Women who breastfeed are less likely to develop breast cancer. This study was published in The Lancet in 2002, and it contained over 80% of the worldwide epidemiological data on breast cancer and breastfeeding. And what did they find? Essentially, for every year that you breastfeed, you decrease the risk of breast cancer by about 4%. Okay, you might say, well, big deal, 4%. But look here, if you breastfeed for 6 years, you decrease your risk of breast cancer by almost 30%. And it doesn't have to be one baby for 6 years. It can be two babies for 3 years, four babies for, okay, six babies for 1 year each, 12 babies for 6 months each. All right. What does it mean? About 470,000 women in developed countries and 320,000 women in developing countries were diagnosed with breast cancer in 1990. Based on estimates obtained here, if women in developed countries have 2.5 children on average, a bit of a disturbing sort of conflict, but breastfed each child for 6 months longer than they currently do, about 25,005% of breast cancers could be prevented every year. If each child were breastfed for an additional 12 months, about 50,000 breast cancers might be prevented every year. More maternal risks, difficulty with weight loss, disempowerment, increased difficulty in attachment with the baby, and the cost. And this is a study that was done in Connecticut, I believe, where they looked at women who were breastfeeding and women who were not breastfeeding, and they looked at their bone density. And as you can see, the women who were not breastfeeding maintained a higher bone density, which was about the same as before they got pregnant, whereas the breastfeeding mothers lost considerable amounts of calcium. But when they weaned their babies, and I guess for the purpose of the study, everybody weaned the baby in about 7 months, the breastfeeding mother's bone density actually rebounded to higher levels than the bone density of the mothers who were not breastfeeding at all. Type 2 diabetes, I know that you've heard of this, that the longer duration of breastfeeding is associated with reduced incidence of type 2 diabetes in two large cohorts of mothers. This is another study that confirms that. The metabolic syndrome that is decreased in women who breastfeed. Duration of lactation is associated with lower prevalence of metabolic syndrome in a dose-response manner in middle-life prepubescent women. What is metabolic syndrome? It's a clustering of metabolic abnormalities, including insulin resistance, dyslipidemia, hypertension, and obesity. Women with metabolic syndrome are at increased risk of diabetes, major cardiovascular events, and increased all-cause mortality. Risks to society, formulas and environmental hazard. There's a loss of contraceptive effect. There's a loss of security and a stable beginning for the child. This video, you can click it. And it's an ad for a Chinese formula where they say that in the last 5 years they sold enough formula to cover the Sahara Desert. It's kind of clever, but it's also kind of frightening.